when the Lord Jesus' friend Lazarus died, he was 4 days delayed in coming to their home. He had been to their home many times. Martha was upset with him. She wanted to know, where have you been? Look for you yesterday, and here you come today. Took you 4 days to get here. If you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Jesus said in John 11, show me where you've laid him. She took him to the tomb, and the Lord cried for the loss of his friend. He said to Martha, I am the resurrection and the life. He or she that believes in me shall never perish. They shall not die, but have everlasting life. Do you believe this? Now, that's the question he asked Martha. She said, I believe at the last day there'll be a resurrection, but not now, it's too late. Jesus said, no, he's not dead. We have gathered for the first of two celebrations for the life and legacy and love of Carolyn, but she is not dead. I guess, Dottie, you're the youngest one here. Let me say this to you. It comes from the world of jazz. Kirk Whelan, a good friend of mine, his father, K.T. Whelan, was the pastor of the Olivet Baptist Church in Memphis, Tennessee, for 35 years. For 30 of those years, he was what we called in the church a tent maker. Like Paul the tent maker, he had two jobs, full-time jobs. One was as a pastor, the other was supervising the post office. And for 30 of those years, while he was supervisor, his number two in command always requested to work the 3 to 11 shift, 3 in the afternoon until 11 o'clock at night, where he got off every night at 11 o'clock. When asked why he preferred those weird hours, he said because he wanted to be home in the morning when his children woke up for school, so he could fix their breakfast, their lunch, and get dinner prepared to the point that when their mother came home, all she would have to do was warm it up. And they granted his request. You've never seen, you're too young to have seen a trolley car. Do you know what a trolley car looks like? If you watch movies, old movies, they'll show you. It looks like a bus, but it has a long arm extending up to some wires. It's run electrically. You pull the cord inside to signal the driver when you're going to get off. He got off every night from the post office at 11. And by the time the trolley got to a stop, he pulled the cord. And he knew the trolley driver. They became friends across 30 years, making bets on who was going to retire first, the trolley driver or the post office manager. One night, there were some kids from Memphis State University on the trolley with him. When he pulled the cord, it was 5 minutes to 12. Which was the same time each night, but the kids had never been on the trolley to see this man get off the trolley, walk into the cemetery, and keep walking, and they started giggling and laughing. Charlie Jones said, what's so funny? They said, nothing but a fool would go into the cemetery at 5 minutes to midnight. He stopped the trolley, and there were only passengers left. He said, come to this side of the trolley and look out the window, tell me what you see. They looked out the window. They saw some lights off in the distance. He said, what do you see? They said, we see some lights. He said, that's the man's home. If he stayed on the trolley until I made a full circle around the cemetery. It would be another hour before I got him home. He's not going into the cemetery. He's going through the cemetery to get home. Grandma's not going into the cemetery. She's going through the cemetery to get home. Shall the dead live again? The church members in Corinth wanted to know how, if somebody's burned up, how, if somebody's cremated, how, if somebody is put underneath the earth, are they going to live again? The Apostle Paul, in the first chapter of first book of Corinthians, 15th chapter, gives a detailed expression. Now, has Ernie ever showed you anything about planting food or fruit? So you know the seed you put in the ground is not what it looks like when it comes out of the ground. So it is with these bodies we live in, whether burned or buried. When the resurrection occurs, it's a different body. It looks nothing like the body we know and we're familiar with. As I thought about Carolyn's life, I thought about three words that describe her. She was beautiful, a beautiful woman. I don't mean just as a majorette at Dunbar High School. I mean she was beautiful in Pine Bluff when you two met. She stayed beautiful for all of her life, not just beautiful on the outside, but beauty on the inside. The way she helped others, the way she was dedicated to service. She was a beautiful woman. She was a blessed woman. God blessed her life with you. God blessed her life with the Big Ten. God blessed her life with memories and loved ones in the Lynx and in Delta Sigma Theta Sorority. God blessed her life and yours to be personal friends of Martin Luther King Jr. Did anybody here see the movie Boss the other night? The documentary is still available on PBS. Please look at it, because it shows the A.G. Gaston Hotel and restaurant which you two managed. She was blessed to be in the presence of Wyatt T. Walker, William Walter Fauntleroy, Ralph Abernathy, Fred Shuttlesworth in Birmingham. She was blessed to be a part of the Civil Rights Movement. She was blessed when you moved to DuPage County to take her unashamedly black personality into Wheaton school system and bring about not only the Martin Luther King Jr. holiday as a federal holiday, but the Martin Luther King programs at her school. She was blessed by the Chicago Tribune, which honored her and her achievements. She was blessed to be your wife, blessed to be your mother, blessed to be your grandmother. She was beautiful, she was blessed, and she was a believer. When Jesus said to Martha, "Believest thou this? Do you believe this, that you shall live again?" Carolyn was a believer. She not only founded with you and others the DuPage County Bethel, AME Church of DuPage. Long before she got to DuPage, she was a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. A little girl, 6 years old, tried to learn from her grandfather horticulture. Every plant she would plant, whether inside the house or outside the house, would die. And she was about to give up when her mother took her to the florist and said, "Can you help her? She thinks she doesn't have a green thumb. Everything she plants dies. Chrysanthemums die, daisies die, to everything." So he pulled out a little box with some seeds in it and said, "This plant will never die. Where do you want to plant it?" She said, "Right here." He said, "No, let's plant it over there." So they took it to the wall, planted it by the wall. And it did fine for many, many years. By the time she was 16, getting ready to graduate from high school, her plant started dying. She was heartbroken. She was not only heartbroken, she was angry. She She went back to the floor and said, "You told me a lie." He said, "My plant would never die, it's dead." He said, "It can't be dead." She said, "It's dead, I'm telling you." He said, let me see. She took him back to the house, back to the wall, and sure enough, the plant was drooped over. He said, "Do you have a ladder?" She said, "That's not gonna help my plant." He said, "Let me get a ladder." She got a ladder, he put it against the wall, climbed up the ladder, looked over the other side of the wall, said, "Come here. Climb this ladder and look up the other side of the wall and tell me what you see." When she looked, there was her plant blooming, her beautiful plant, had grown under the wall and was blooming on the other side of the wall. When we climb the ladder of death and look over the wall of eternity, we will see Carolyn again, for she is not dead, she is yet alive. Inasmuch, therefore, as it has pleased Almighty God in God's wisdom to take from this world the soul of our dearly departed wife, mother, grandmother, sister, and friend, Link Delta Christian, we therefore commit our ashes to the urn, looking for the resurrection in the last day, when he will appear, and the corruptible bodies of those who live and believe in him shall be changed and made like unto his own glorious body. I heard a voice from heaven, writes John in the book of Revelation, saying, "Blessed are they who die in the Lord. Blessed are the believers who die believing that they shall live again, for they rest from their labors and their amazing works to follow them." Carolyn had amazing works, from Little Block to Pine Bluff, to DuPage, to Wheaton, to Olympia Fields. Amazing works. A beautiful woman, a blessed woman, a woman who was a believer. Would you take the hand of the person sitting next to you, and together we say the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, and from whom no secrets are hid, our hearts are hurting right now, for we have lost one of your children. We say in the English language, we have lost her. We haven't lost her, because for something to be lost or someone to be lost means we don't know where they are. We thank God this day and tomorrow at Trinity, because we know exactly where she is. The Word of God says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Therefore, we know that when this earthly tabernacle shall have dissolved, when these earthly bodies are disintegrated or incinerated, we have another building eternal in the heavens, not made by human hands. She is with you, and we put her in your hands, thanking you for allowing us the privilege of being loved by her and the privilege of loving her. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, we pray, and all the people together will say amen.
Amen.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause God's face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and grant you eternal peace. As Carolyn Gibson rests in peace forevermore, let us all together again say, amen.
to meet you. I met you a long time ago. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
She
I love you so much.
She don't know what to talk. I was talking to your daughter.
I love you so much. Thank you.
Did you hear me calling when Jerry Heller called you? I called you Gip.
Yeah.
Love you, man.
Yeah, I know. You remember you came to the house and married Nell?
Yes, I did.
And Penelope?
Yeah, Lillian's sister.
Hmm?
Lillian Butler's sister.
Yeah. And then when Jerry got her divorce, it's only you and Carolyn went down there with her.
Right.
Yeah, yeah. I want you to know that. I'll be by to see you.
Okay.
We were going to read a proclamation from the village.